Please be seated. Good morning. How are we all? Good. Shall I bring your attention to our notice sheet, which is done very beautifully. Thank you so much. And I should say it's Mary who worked on this notice sheet. I have no part in it. And there are all other groups share the information and everything. So can I request all of you to please clap for all these people, all the team who work behind it. Thank you so much. Thank you. It's beautifully done, and they sometimes jokes and the other things. The last week, it was something about the garden. It was absolutely beautiful. And those things are not mine. Mary get them or write them her own and put it on notice sheet. So thank you so much. Right. So Sunday the 14th is Christian Aid Lunch. The details are there. Saturday the 14th, which is, and Saturday, Sunday 14th to Saturday 20th is Christian Aid door-to-door collection. They are still looking for volunteers. If you need, if you want, please give your, no, you don't need a volunteers? No? It's all covered? Oh, well done. Right, okay, that's perfect. And then Sunday 21st is car treasure hunt. Again, cost is £5 per adult and £3.50 for a child. If you could please join. See, all this money we are gathering, don't think we are greedy and we are trying to gather money from you. This is all going to go to Christian Aid for good, noble causes. So please join. Yeah, it's good. It's still going for a good and noble cause, you know. Yes, just to keep them right. Yes, sorry. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. And then Sunday 28th will be the well. So please join and please share this notice sheet with the other people as well. So what a beautiful day, isn't it? And on that note, I thought, well, let me start some exercise. So I went out to run, but then I forgot something and I come back home. You know what I forgot? That I'm not fit to run for more than 2 minutes. I'm out of shape. That's what I forgot, you know? And I think why I'm not fit, because it's feel like Shikha don't feed me for good food. You know why? Well, I think it's men's responsibility to feed the women. Ask me why. Remember, Eve feed Adam. And what happened? They were chased out from the Garden of Eden. So I think it's men's responsibility to feed women. Well, you may not agree, but yes, I can tell all your husband to feed the wives. Anyway, today is a very important day, 7th of May, 5th Sunday after Easter. And important why? Because we just celebrated the Good Friday and the Easter. And today's theme is very close to our heart, because Jesus said, do not let your heart be troubled. Last week we were talking about the Good Shepherd, how Good Shepherd take care of his sheep, how Good Shepherd feed and take us to the right pasture so we can be fed, and how the good sheep listen and hear him and then follow him. And this week God is talking about, let not your heart be troubled. But how come our hearts not be troubled? We have worries, we have wars, we have unrest, we have distress, we have anxiety, we have so much on in our life. How can we not be troubled? Well, God knows that our heart is very, very important, because our hearts keep us healthy. Yes, pump all our blood in our veins and everything. But also, we always say that heart has, if you have a heart, you have that love, you have that compassion, that warmth for the community, for humanity. And heart is very, very important. But then God is talking about here that do not let your heart be troubled. When normally this passage, that line, you must have heard so many times when you attend the funeral. This is one of the favorite passage for a person like me to talk about, when it says, do not let your heart be troubled. I have many mentions for you. But today, I'm not talking about a funeral sermon here. I'm talking about which might speak to your heart and bring you to God, bring you to the foot of cross again. And that's what's important for us being Christian. So let's take a moment of silence and then prepare our hearts to worship our God in truth and in spirit. God, who called his people to repentance, who has set the world on a course towards the coming kingdom, who has appointed his Son as Savior and King. Lord, you alone are worthy to raise the dead to life and forgive sin and evil deeds. Lord, may we proclaim the good news of your Lordship to the heavens, to the hills, to the valleys, to the plains, and at this church, and to the depth of our sea. The sea of pain, the sea of confusion and despair. But Lord, we want to proclaim your name. So prepare us for this day and prepare our hearts so our hearts won't be troubled, but we bring our center through your words, through the hymn we sing to you and the prayer we bring and offer to you, Lord. In Jesus' almighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's all stand if you can and sing our first hymn, O Lord My God, hymn number 154. Thank you. Let's join our hearts in prayer. Lord God Almighty, Lord, we thank you this day and we praise you for this morning. And Lord, thank you for the opportunity you have given us in this good land to gather and to worship you without fear. Without fear of persecution and rejection and judgment. Most holy God, we pray that you would be with us in this place of praise and prayer, and that through the ministry of your Holy Spirit, we'll see you face to face. You would form the minds of your faithful people into a single will, your will. Make us love that what you command and desire, what you promise through your word, that amid all the changes of this world, all the wars and tribulations, all the confusion and despair and fear and pain, our hearts may be fixed. Our heart may be fixed where true joy is found, which is under the foot of your cross. And that our every action might show forth the light of your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, he who lives and reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And also in always our prayers, and especially the prayer you taught us and ask us to pray together as a family. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now please request Linda to come forward and do the reading. Reading is from Gospel according to St. John, chapter 14, verses 1 through 14.
John chapter 14, verses 1 to 14. The way, the truth, and the life. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The Father revealed. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. The answered prayer. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Amen. Thanks be to God for this reading from his holy word.
Thank you, Linda, for reading this beautiful passage. Yes, the passage again reminds you of the time of funeral when a lot of ministers use this passage to give the comfort to the family And I am not disputing that. I am not disputing that this passage couldn't be used for afterlife. But what my concerns are when Jesus said, do not let your heart be troubled. Why he's saying that? Does he don't know that hearts are troubled? Yes, they are always. Well, the big claims Jesus is making here in this passage, something very similar, we saw it last week when I was talking about Jesus is the good shepherd. In that passage in John 10, 1 to 10, Jesus was saying that I am, same saying he used when God said same thing to Moses when he said, I am who I am. And last week, Jesus used the same phrase. He said, I am the good shepherd, and I am the gate. And here, he's making three claims. He's saying, I am the Father, and Father is in me. I am the Father, and Father is in me. And then second claim he makes, he said, whoever has seen me has seen the Father. And the third claim he's making is that, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. There are many prophets and so-called savior and incarnation on this earth who tried to say, who tried to be God, but they're all dead. Jesus is the only one who is life. Prophet Muhammad said that, you know, you seek the truth and you will find it. Jesus said, I am the truth. And a lot of other prophets says, we don't know the way, we are seeking for it. But Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Jesus has fulfilled whatever we required in this life. The way to the life, Jesus is the way. The way to the life, because Jesus is the life. And again, on that journey, you can't walk on the lie. You have to walk on truth. And Jesus said, I am the truth as well. Now, either Jesus is the biggest liar and fraud ever born on this earth, and we shouldn't follow him and do not waste even our second on him, or he is the true Savior. He is the true Messiah who died for you and for me. One day, Karl Barth, who was one of the renowned professor and theologian and one of the brilliant mind at his age, at his time, he was preaching or he was taking a seminar in one of the university. And a student came and said, Professor, can I ask you something? He said, yes, go ahead. He said, is it not that God revealed himself in all the religion, including Christianity? In some way, somehow, you can find God in all the religion. And Karl Barth, in his thundering voice, and as polite he could be, he said, no. No, God has not revealed himself in any religion, even in Christianity. You know why? Because God has revealed himself in only one thing, and that is Jesus Christ. If you don't have a Jesus Christ, you don't have God. If you have never seen Jesus, you have never seen God. If you don't believe in Jesus, you never believe in Father as well. There is only one way, and that is Jesus. There is only one life, and that is Jesus. And there is only one truth, and that is Jesus Christ. So our life is something very similar. We go through a lot of time that we try, well, a lot of other people, I would say, try to find truth in so many different things, in so many different ways. They want to find truth, but Jesus is the only truth. And then he said, look after your heart. Come back to our theme. He said, look after your heart because your heart is important. Don't let your heart be troubled. You believe in Father, believe in me too. But our life is difficult. There are a lot of confusion. The world tries and makes sure that our heart is torn apart. There are a lot of confusion, a lot of stress, hunger, poverty, wars, enemies, and so on. The list goes on, and our hearts just torn like this, like what I'm doing. Even we have Jesus there. Our hearts are torn, isn't it? That's our heart. Fragile. Like this paper, we easily get hurt, don't we? We can easily get offended. We easily get unrest, anxiety, stress. We easily lose our marbles, people said, isn't it? But you know what Jesus is promising us? Jesus promised that I will renew your heart. I will give you a heart of, I'll take your heart of stone, and I will give you a heart of love. I will restore you. I will renew you, and I'll give you something which is God said, I will renew your strength. Don't promote me as a musician. Promote me as a minister, okay? I know I'm very bad in that. God said, no matter how much your heart is torn, no matter how many people offend you and break your heart, you believe in me. You believe in me, and I will restore everything for you. I will restore your heart. And that's the reason I always say, God don't change species from goat to sheep. No. But he take a heart of stone from us and give us the heart of flesh and blood. And he restores our heart through only one thing, through his blood. That's it. That's what God is doing for you and for me. So don't believe in anything else, my friends. Believe in God and God only. There is only one way, and that's Jesus Christ and nothing else. May God bless you all. Let's all stand again and sing our next hymn, Jesus Calls Us Here to Meet Him, hymn number 510. So what troubles your heart today? What trouble your hearts today? You must have a big list of what is hurting you today, what troubles your heart today. For me, the list is long, and it's obviously not pretty either. I think about a lot of things going around in our world, the violence and the suffering in the world, the persecuted Christians, especially in India. I think about healthcare, the immigrants, the refugees, about violence, about racism, about poverty, about stories of bullying and suicide and increasing tensions and impatience around our globe. I think about those grieving and mourning of death of a loved one, especially all of them are almost soul ones, isn't it? I think about families that are struggling, spouses that are divorcing, not able to stay together with each other, children that go hungry every night, and people that are hanging on just by a thread. I think about my own sorrows, my own losses and disappointments, and the list goes on and on and on. Well, despite what Jesus say about not letting our hearts be troubled, my heart is troubled. And I suspect your hearts might be too. What would you add to my list? Maybe you might have a long list as well. What is troubling your heart today? None of us get through this life without a troubled heart, can we? No, we cannot. Don't think we can look at the pain of the world today, the suffering of our loved ones or our own wounds and hurts and the problems and the despairs and the confusion and the pain and the illness will not trouble our heart. It will, and it is. And that's the context actually in which I hear Jesus say, do not let your heart be troubled. That is the time when Jesus is speaking to them. It's not what that's any different context in which Jesus said those words as well 2,000 years ago. It is a night of Last Supper. What does Last Supper mean? Why is it called Last Supper? Because it was Last Supper of Jesus before he was going to die. Right? This was the Last Supper. Jesus has announced his departure from this world, his death. Feet have been washed. Judas has left the table and stepped into the night of time of betrayal. Peter will break his silence with a threefold denial. Thomas is lost and asks, how can we know the way? Philip has lost his center and can't see what is right in front of him. Lord, show us the Father and we will be satisfied. He says, well, obviously, but at that time, Jesus is saying, do not let your heart be troubled. Are you joking? Jesus, do you know what's going on? Just a week ago, on the triumphal entry, we thought that you are the king. We thought that you will restore our kingdom. We thought that you will be the Messiah. We thought you will bring us the kingdom of heaven on earth for us. And you are saying, let your heart be troubled. You are going to die. We just followed you for 3 years. Just 3 years of ministry. What will that do? We have not even proclaimed your word, your teachings to the whole world. What's going to happen? And you are saying to us, do not let your heart be troubled. Are you kidding us? Do you know what's going about around us? Are you serious about when you say that, do not let your heart be troubled? And think about your heart when you were in Gethsemane. Your blood, your sweat was coming out as blood. Think about Mary and Martha when you cried on the death of Lazarus. And you're asking us, Lord, let your heart be troubled? Well, what is Jesus telling us is not as if there is an on-off switch of our troubled heart. No. How do we begin to make sense of today's gospel in a world whose heart is constantly troubled? Our hearts are constantly troubled for one or the other way. There's no rest. There's no rest in our heart. It's not hard to understand why this text is so often used in burial liturgy, my friends. Death troubles our hearts and we want to find some balance, some stability, some harmony, don't we? This text, however, is about more than the afterlife. It's to do something with us now. It has something to say right here, right now, for our lives. It speaks to us the very circumstances that trouble our hearts today, this morning. Maybe yesterday, maybe last week, and maybe the whole year, or maybe our whole life. Think about time when your heart has been troubled. Maybe it is now as well. What does that feel like? It's sore, isn't it? We all experience it in our own ways, but see if this sounds familiar to you. Let me give you this list. Isolation, paralyzed, overwhelmed, powerless, off balance, out of control, disconnected, afraid, thought of spinning in your hearts, no stability, despair, grief, tears, anger, loss of somebody, of your loved one, long-term illness? What is it? Do you recognize any of these? I think we all have something to relate with. In the midst of troubled heart, the unspoken question is this: will the center hold? Will the center hold, or is everything collapsing around us? Thomas and Philip are feeling the collapse, all the other disciples too. Much of the world is, maybe you are too. Will the center hold? For all the disciples, they ran away. And you know what Judas has done, because everything around him was collapsed and he can only find one way to end his misery. Instead of recentering himself with Christ, he committed what was the heinous crime at that time. Maybe we all are too at that stage. Will the center hold? That's our question, isn't it? Do not let your heart be troubled. Jesus recognized that our hearts are troubled. He's not oblivious to the fact that you are not troubled. You are not well. You are going through problems and troubles, and your hearts are troubled. Our heart, he knows that. He's not warning us about the future condition here, though. He knows the troubling has already begun in our world. We can see it in us because he experienced it within himself. He also knows that our lives and the worlds are not defined by or limited to what troubles us. And we shouldn't limit ourselves because of the troubles we go through. What if not letting our hearts be troubled began with looking into our hearts and seeing and naming with our troubles? That means facing ourselves, facing our lives, facing our world, but most importantly, facing your God. And the God will teach you how to face yourself, how to face your lives, how to face the world. And that's what's more important. That may be the first and the most difficult thing Jesus asks of us in today's gospel. Let not your heart be troubled. But, Lord, we do not know the way. Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Thomas speaks here. And I think Thomas is speaking for all of us here. We don't know the way either. Though Jesus was with them for 3 years, he is still asking, Lord, show us the way. We don't know the way. We have lost our center too. Same like the disciples. How do we recenter it? Where do we go when it seems everything is collapsing around us? That's what the situation for disciples as well. Jesus announced his death and he is going away from them. Here is a paradox, however. Sometimes we have to lose our center in order to find it, and it's not God-made. There is a method in madness sometime. And I said, it's not the God's way. It's a part of the human condition, my friend. Sometimes it's come out of our circumstances we don't create or choose. Other times it's the consequences of our choices and our own actions. We bring this, that we lose our center. However, or regardless, Jesus says that this is not the place to stay or way to live. It is not the life he lives or even offers us. The life he is offering us is abundant life. If your heart is troubled, then it is time for us to recenter. Recentering doesn't mean our hearts won't be troubled. No, he's not saying that. He's not saying that. It doesn't necessarily fix the problem either, whatever it may be. It means that our lives are tethered to something greater than ourselves and our surrounding. It means that our hearts are held secure by the divine life of Jesus Christ, who was crucified, resurrected, ascended to heaven, and now sitting at the right hand of the Father. And that is more important. Jesus is reminding us that there is center, and that center is not us. The center is God. It is not United Kingdom and the King and the laws and the Constitution. No, it's not. It is not the church or our deeds and doctrines. No, it is not. It is not for our success, our accomplishment, our position, or our power, or our wealth, or our health. No, it is not. We do not have to be the center, nor do we need to establish it. In fact, we can't, as you all know by your own experiences. Instead, we awaken of it. We awaken to it. We already know the way. And the place, the center, and that is Jesus Christ and nothing else. The Father house is within you, my friends. The kingdom is within us. Whoever you are, there is a center. Regardless of what troubles you, there is a center. Wherever you are, there is the center. Not because you are the center, but because God is the center and God is within us when you follow Christ, when you follow on his ways. So in the language of today's gospel, a center is the Father's house, and there are many dwelling places in this house for every troubled heart. And I'm talking about the dwelling place as the ways God's life intersect with our own. Mercy, forgiveness, justice, generosity, compassion, healing, love, beauty, wisdom, hope, courage, joy, and intimacy with God. And these should be our dwelling places. These are the dwelling places for troubled hearts, for you and for me. Places of recentering. I always tell you, if you follow Jesus Christ because you want to go to heaven, because you want to be blessed, because you want good health, you are following a wrong God. You are following a wrong Jesus. Follow Jesus for Jesus and nothing else. Don't be selfish. He loves you because you're worth it. He loves you even when you were a sinner. Even when he's not getting anything from you, he still loves us. And that's what we need to love back, God. Every time we live into the expression or the express the divine attributes in our way of being, with our words, with our action, we regain the center. We restore the balance and take up the residence in the Father's house through this list which I've just shared with you. What is in you today that needs recentering? Find out. Find out what is this that needs recentering in you. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. Well, I hear those words and I imagine a sign blinking at a heartbeat. You know, when you go to tourist places, there are heart blinking like that. It says, room available. Rooms available. And in God's dwelling house, rooms available for all of you. He's a good shepherd, my friends. When you lose your marbles, let him gather. Because if you try to gather them, you will slip on those marbles, isn't it? Let him gather it. Let him be the good shepherd and you be the sheep. He will gather you to the right pastures, take you to the clean waters, and you'll be blessed. And that's what God wants from you and for me. Don't try to recenter it yourself. Surrender in the hands of God, and he will recenter you. In my house, in my God's house, there are many dwelling places. Don't let your heart be troubled. He will take care of you. God bless you. Let's join our hearts in prayer. Truly, O God, you are great and greatly to be praised. Through Christ Jesus, your Son, you have shown yourself to us. For he is in you and you are in him. Grant therefore, dear Father, that we come to him, the living stone, rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in your sight. And that like living stones, we ourselves may be built into a spiritual house, a royal priesthood, your holy people, the temple of your presence in our world. Lord, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for in Christ Jesus you have conquered the power of death and enable us to face our own death and the loss of those we love with trust and confidence. Help us to live with joyful anticipation of entering the heavenly places that Jesus has prepared for us in your house, and to show forth our hope in him to all whom we meet before we gather before your throne in glory. Father, we pray for your church, the church of Christ Jesus, your Son. And we pray for Carstairs Parish Church as well, Lord. May our life as your holy people always be marked by faithful testimony in both word and deed. Like Jesus, may we be known as people of prayer and service, truth and love, mercy and help, and the way and the ambassador of healing, especially of those who are in need, those that our world rejects, those that are without your Son in our lives, we ourselves might turn away from. Now, Lord, we pray for people all over the world who long to see your face and do not know how to find you. May they see you in us and us in you through the loving care you call us to show. We pray for the victims of neglect and of oppression, for those scorned and mocked, for those who are overlooked by the rest of our world. May they be convinced that they are precious in your sight. And may these needs be met according to the abundance of your grace. Now, Lord, we pray for our families and for our neighbors and for all those whom you have placed upon our hearts this day, those who grieve and those who rejoice, those who struggle with conflict in their families and those who celebrate new birth, those who need work and those who need a special healing or a sense of peace to come over them. Hear now the prayers of thanksgiving and intercession we make for those, and we name them in silence before you right now. Loving God, do not let our hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Rather, fill our lives in deeds of devotion and service, and help us to follow Jesus, the way, the truth, the life, with joy and peace, knowing that we are safe forever with him, who lives and reigns with the Holy Spirit, one God, both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Shall we all stand once again and sing our closing hymn, hymn number 192, All My Hope on God Is Founded. Standing while we pray for our offering. Gracious God, we hear the words of Jesus saying that anyone who has faith in him will do his work. We who have faith in the risen Christ stand here today, Lord, and we offer to you not only these tithes and offering, in this place and in so many other ways we share with you and share with your people, but ourselves. Bless us and what we offer, so that your love and and your saving and your healing power may be evident to all, so that your name glorified forever and ever. Amen. Let's receive the blessing of God. Go in peace. Go in peace as people of the way, love and care for one another in the name of Christ Jesus. And may the blessing of his Father and ours go with you. And may the Holy Spirit uphold you and sustain you. And may the sun shine upon the path you walk and guide you today, day by day, till you join all the saints and all the angels arrive in the place of everlasting glory. Thank you, and please be seated.